I want to welcome Agile XRM to the podcast. I've known the people at Agile XRM for the past 12 years. I've seen how their business process management tool can add massive value to complex organizational processes in sectors such as finance and government. If you have complex processes or a need for dialogues on the Power Platform or Dynamics 365, take a look at how this BPM tool can add value. You can find them at agilexrm.com or check out the show notes for more details. Welcome to the Power 365 show, where I interview staff at Microsoft across the Power Platform and Dynamics 365 technology stack. I hope you'll find this podcast educational and inspire you to do more with this great technology. Now, let's get on with the show. In this episode, we'll be focusing on Microsoft Co-Pilot and its capabilities, what's changed, what's happening, what's new. Today's guest is from Redmond, Washington in the US. He works at Microsoft as a principal program manager. He regularly creates apps and automations with Power Platform, even his free time. And for his family, he started his Microsoft career in 2018 to build the Power Platform business in Japan. You can find links to his bio, social media, etc., in the show notes for this episode. Welcome to the show, Taiki.
Hi, Mark. Nice to meet you.
You too. It's good to have you back on the show. I think it was show 290. 290 was the last time you were on, which is about over 200 episodes ago. So
wow.
I'm in the high 400s at the moment. So yeah, it's good to have you back.
Yeah, I'm honored to be here again.
Tell me, life's getting back to normal for you now, I take it, with COVID squarely in the rear vision mirror. What does your week-to-week, day-to-day look like when you're not at Microsoft?
That's an interesting one. So right now in Redmond, Washington, you know, it's kind of all sunny and it's a beautiful weather outside. So I tend to kind of spend time barbecuing and hanging out with friends and folks. Definitely the COVID has died down. So it's not a lot more, you know, time spent outside and inside for sure.
Nice. Do you get back to Japan much?
I do. Actually, my family is now back in Japan. So I actually fly now probably 2 or 3 months each time back and forth and all that. Yeah.
Do you miss home?
I do. Yes, definitely. Especially Japanese food. Maybe I shouldn't tell my wife this, but yeah, definitely the food. Of course, my wife and the kids too. But yeah, I do miss them a lot too, for sure.
Yeah. But I mean, Japanese food is just so unique, right? As in every, all the Japanese food I've eaten is like a work of art and is amazing. And so, yeah, how do you make it yourself when you're not at home in Japan? Like, how do you deal with the gap, or in Seattle, is there options for you that are high quality?
Yeah, luckily we do have a lot of Japanese stores or Asian supermarkets around in Seattle, mm-hmm. and Redmond as well. So I tend to kind of buy the ingredients there, and then I cook a lot of stuff actually at home myself.
Nice.
Yeah, maybe not
very
sushi.
Very good. So not sushi?
No. I can't
do you
make
not
that
roll them in all yourself?
No, I mean, I know that they have it, but no, I don't make sushi myself for sure, no.
But do you, if you had the choice of beef, or as opposed to fish-based diet, do you reckon you lean more to the beef side of things, or lamb, or more fish?
Oh, that's a good question. I actually equally like both, to be really honest.
Yeah.
I actually came from a place called Kobe, where, you know, I think it's famous for Kobe beef. For me, mm-hmm. personally, over the years, it has gone a little bit too much for me in terms of the fattiness and everything. My stomach can't cope it. So I suppose in that sense, I actually prefer fish more. But yeah.
Yeah. So tell us, what are you up to these days in Microsoft? What team do you work in? What's your general focus?
I think in the last episode, I was talking about how I joined this PowerCat team, where we focus mm-hmm. directly with customers within the engineering team. I'm still part of that same team, but my focus has shifted from directly engaging with customers to finding out most recently about you know, how the Co-Pilot and AI and generative AI in particular is enabling people and the customers across the globe. So that's where I'm trying to figure out, you know, what are the customers are doing, how they're using it, what are the best practices that we potentially could get out of those kind of stories as well. So that's my personal mission right now.
And so what are you seeing? Like, you know, I think it's IDC has coined a term, AI everywhere. We've obviously heard the announcements around the M365 add-on SKU, which is gives you Co-Pilot in the Office suite of products. I'm starting to have customers ask, does that automatically give it to us in the Power Platform? And is there a license cost for the Power Platform? But more than those type of things, because obviously customers are starting to talk about it now. You know, they've heard of co-pilots and the concept of a human in the loop, you know, assistance in the use of AI. But are you seeing, and, you know, without mentioning customers' names or anything like that, but in different industries, are you starting to see the early signs of adoption across the Power Platform in the context of AI? Outside of AI Builder, but more in this co-pilot space, what type of use cases are you starting to see bubble up, I suppose?
So I think I would say there are two main different impacts that's been provided with co-pilot and generative AI capabilities in the Power Platform space. First one I can definitely showcase to you as an example, and actually can provide real names to this now it's gone public, is the career transformation. That's definitely the earliest signals that we see from co-pilot space. So one example I can give you here is this lady called Miyu Takai, who is happens to be in Japan. So she was a lady in Japan who used to do fax ordering entries into an Excel spreadsheet. So she would receive fax orders that would come out in a paper, and then she would go and enter that detail into an Excel spreadsheet. And that was her beginning of her career. So she had no experience, you know, around the programming skills as such. Was very far from IT, and was kind of like this general affairs person who was doing that. And over the years, she finally met Microsoft 365 to begin with, and started playing around with SharePoint because the company allowed her to do it, because there wasn't really any governance or any of that stuff in place yet. So she was playing around, and then she started finding out about Power Automate and Power Apps. And eventually, you know, although she had no prior experiences, she would now be able to learn all these new equations. For example, in Power Apps, like the split function, where she would go and, you know, she would have no idea of like what split function does. She didn't do it in Excel either, but she would then be able to use the earlier days of Copilot. You know, I think it was called Power Apps Ideas, where it would come up automatically using GPT behind the scenes and actually create an equation that's suitable for it. And that allowed her to upskill herself and to become now, she actually transformed into a new career and becoming a Power Platform engineer in a Power Platform partner. So she...
Wow.
Yeah. So she, you know, career transformed herself and upskilled herself through generative AI capabilities, even before it was called Co-Pilot. And now she's able to do this on her own. And she's training customers. She's building, you know, some new apps based on the Co-Pilot capabilities to kind of come up with a prototype and learn new skills from it. So that was one example. The other example I'd like to showcase to you, and this only literally came out last week, so it's very new, about this lady called Ashley Francis. And she was based in Seattle. And she's a CPA, a certified public accountant. Again, she's been like 20 years in industry without prior experiences in IT. She used to do a lot of her stuff in Excel spreadsheets without even a macro or a VBA as such. But she found back 2022 in October, so this is only last year, she finally found out about Power Automate and the Power Platform. And she started to start using things like Bing AI capabilities, and find out all these different potential automation ideas. And eventually, she used Describe It to Design It capabilities in Power Automate to actually create an entire flow that you can use to build cloud flows, right? And that was one of her first ways of finding out how to create Power Automate flows. And eventually, in a month after she had this findings about Power Automate, she built her first flow entirely on her own using GPT, talking to ChatGPT or using Bing AI, and kind of using it to, you know, its best potential from both of these capabilities, and then build a flow herself. And eventually now she's used even AI Builder to extract different sets of data directly from these tax forms directly, you know, related to her business. And she wasn't obviously, you know, having any prior experiences in data science or in writing Pythons or anything. So she's seen all these other folks who is showcasing, again, in the accountant space, where they were using Python scripts and other systems to extract these kind of data. But she was able to do it all without any of those Python or any of the background knowledge in AI to do all of these automations, which I feel is fascinating. So her processes of doing, for example, I think was sending a letter to an engagement letter to customers, which used to take like 30 minutes per each customer, per each engagement. And that's, you know, times by the number of customers could be a huge amount of time, right? But with this, now that she learned Power Automate through Co-Pilot capabilities, through, generative AI, she was now able to do this entire process in less than an hour for every engagement and every customer. So, you know, that's, you know, I think in a sense, it's upskilling the people and to make these career transformations to become now AI-infused CPA person. You know, it's like the latest, you wouldn't be expecting that to happen in just a space of less than a year. But it's happening because of the Co-Pilot and generative AI capabilities. That's one area,
When we look at the Power Platform and that it's a platform for all developers, so whether they start at the one end of the spectrum where it's around personal productivity and, you know, creating some automations or an app for me in the business, kind of like what Excel has been for a lot of people in the past, and then we go through that developer scale and we get people that are building apps for other people. They've developed their skill sets. They know how to create automations. They know how to use connectors. They know how to use Canvas and maybe model-driven. Then we go up, of course, to pro code developers that are doing extending on the platform. When we look at Co-Pilot and we put those two lines side by side, where do you see it kind of support? Who's it supporting at the moment if you look at those spectrum of personal productivity, fusion teams, and then ultimately pro devs working with the Power Platform? Where do you see it kind of its sweet spot? Where in your mind?
So in particular about the Co-Pilot, I think it enables more of the citizen developer spectrum, where I would say, you know, Power Platform and the low-code capabilities, not just specifically Power Platform, but any, you know, even other competitors and other products that out there where we define it as a low-code, used to kind of tend to be those who are a little bit more on the Excel-savvy side of people, right, who would be able to at least maybe understand if equations or a VLOOKUP. You know, that really helps the customer to actually be able to, you know, use these capabilities to an extent. Whereas now with the Co-Pilot, that really lowered the bar on entry. Now you have people who is able to write just Word documents maybe. And in the kind of a same similar sense, as long as the people can actually just write what they want to have, it ultimately kind of figures out, right, using the behind the scenes generative AI capabilities, they ultimately kind of understand what the people want and then convert it into kind of these configurations, where in perhaps cases into an application or in Power Automate to be a flow. So it definitely has lowered that bar and the kind of the criteria that you needed to learn VLOOKUPs and if equations. And now people can, even though they might not use it directly into the production environment right away from these Co-Pilot, it will at least help the people to understand how you can configure it, how to make these settings to then next time when you want to make it yourself, it'll teach them at least really a clear example or a business use case where people can just go and look and say, oh, this is how you can build this app or this is how you can build this flow. You know, that really helps them enable people to develop these stuff more. So in that sense, Co-Pilot directly has definitely enable people to, on the citizen developer side of things, to be more open doors to more people, I would say.
Yeah. The Co-Pilot experience, let's take Power Apps to start with before we look at Power Automate. When Charles Lamanna was on his first presentation of it to the MVP community, and as he was presenting on the main stage, I don't know how many months ago now, I jumped into our MVP tenant and it had already been deployed. So while he did that, I quickly created an app for managing the seeds in my garden, right? I knew it was something totally, because I'm always I hate sample apps that are sample apps or demo data that is says, you know, test one, test two. I like it to be real and tangible. And very quickly, you know, it created me a one table app and it populated it with sample data that was correct sample data, like pumpkin seeds, like corn seeds, like, it, you know, it had that, it understood enough. And from me, of course, just typing in what I wanted. And of course, then I saw the second part of ChatGPT within an app, which is about querying your data, right? Which is, it's really two parts of that story. Now, that's amazing, simple one table app. In your mind, where do you see that movement happening up from the citizen developer into either the fusion team? And even, you know, they say in the stat jumps around 40% of code in GitHub is large language model assisted, right? Mm-hmm. About 40%. I've heard people even go higher than that.
Yeah.
Outside of Microsoft, say that code and that. Where do you think, in a realistic timeline, how far along that developer pool do you think that we will go with things like Co-Pilot, where they are truly, you know, that we've truly really gone to the developer model of explain it and it will build it. How do you, I mean, we've seen a lot of traction. We've had a lot from Microsoft around Copilot, of course, since around that November timeframe last year. But where do you really see, because we're coming up, November's not far around the corner, will be a year in. Are we going to see kind of like Moore's Law, this doubling in, and I'm talking about now inside Microsoft, do we see that kind of, we're just going to leapfrog in where AI is going to go and assist us in the power platform?
Yeah, that's an awesome question. And I think in terms of, you know, enabling pro developers, I think there's two aspects to it. One, you know, from the Co-Pilot perspective, I've seen developers, which I can't disclose names yet because I have never got the right permissions, but I've seen pro developers use the Co-Pilot capabilities first off in Power Apps, where they already had been using Power Apps to, you know, develop things faster. And they would typically spend maybe a day or so to build these apps. And they actually claimed, you know, using Co-Pilot, it took now them 2 hours just to build an app that they would have taken about 6 hours or a day to build. So even for pro developers, it's contributing to build the first, you know, MVP of an app, because it instantly creates an app that's working, right? Although it may be just one table app, but it's already starting to, you know, have the right sample data, have the right details, have the right fields and everything already packed as a first MVP that's working right off just by clicking, you know, generate, and that's it. So that's first aspect of it. And kind of more in a pro developer in a sense of, you know, actually coding and things. I also heard another customer, which actually wasn't a pro developer, but I would say he has converted into a pro developer by using the capabilities with generative AI, where he was building this. He had this requirement to load lots of data into Dataverse. And that was like 60,000 records that he wanted to import. But, you know, if he did this with Power Automate, obviously there's issues around, you know, throttling, and, you know, that could potentially get hit. If you do it from a UI, it can kind of get, you know, tricky with like number of records to the limit. So the guidance, you know, we have in our docs is to use potentially pro code, right? It says write a custom code and then use that to import data. Well, what he did was that he had no experience with C# before, but from using the generative AI and eventually to GitHub Enterprise and Copilot, he managed to write a plugin, a C# plugin. Obviously, that's a proper pro code, and he developed it in 4 hours. And then it was actually used to import the 60,000 records. I mean,
wow.
He wasn't a pro developer, but he, I mean, that is pretty much a pro developer, right? So that happened. And he, at one point, he was going to go and quote to some external partner to kind of develop, get someone to pro code for him. And that was quoting like 50 hours, I think, or so. But yeah, he managed to do it in four. So, yeah, I think that, again, to convert even into your pro code. Also, generative AI is definitely helping there to have more people become pro developers, in a sense, who wasn't maybe wasn't a pro developer, who was maybe a local developer before. But now with having this sense of, you know, because by being a local developer, you already have like the basic knowledge and kind of understanding the concepts and the logic. And although you wouldn't call it code, but programming, you already kind of have that in your mind. So having then an extra layer of, you know, GitHub Copilot to help you even accelerate that to become a C# developer, you know, it converts you into a pro code. So definitely, you know, it definitely helps pro codes to do it even more efficiently. And also helps people to shift from being a low-code developer to a pro-code developer as well. So that's kind of like the two things that I've seen so far in that front.
Have you had any general feedback, you know, outside of the use cases of, you know, a couple of things? And it's interesting because I don't know that it was really mentioned in it, but recently there's been, I think it was a Forrester report came out that now shows the Power Platform as a low-code leader, like not not just a leader, but it is the leader. Right, it's the top of the leader quadrant, and we've seen ServiceNow jump in behind. We've seen Appian and Mendix plummet, really, you know, to some degree. Is the fact that Microsoft is so, you know, iterating at such a phenomenal rate, do you think that is impacting the draw to the platform more and more, that people can see, hey, you know, if we look at the, and I expand on it a bit, if we look at the cloud wars, there's only three people standing at the end of the wars, right? There was Azure, there was AWS, and there was Google Cloud Platform. Really, those are considered the top three. Now we're in the AI, the, you know, the era of AI, which is happening at a phenomenal rate. And there's a lot of predictions that there's only going to be a couple of big AI providers that are at the core of large language models and things like that. And of course, Microsoft's in the driving seat. To all intents and purposes. What do you think the impact that is having, or what are you seeing as the impact that's having on customers switching to the Power Platform, choosing it, even swapping out a lot of the point solutions that they're seeing in market, whether they be automation point solutions or app point solutions? What's your observations been?
Definitely, I think the generative AI capabilities and the co-pilots that we announced has provided a big impact towards how the customers are making decisions over which platforms to go for, which, you know, products to go for. Obviously, you know, with the recent macroeconomic, you know, changes as well, now the customers are being asked to kind of do more with less, right? And I think that's something that that phrase has been particularly used with Satya's keynote as well several times now. And, you know, having these co-pilot and generative AI capabilities definitely directly relates to that do more with less part of things. So, you know, the example I showed you about that, you know, people being able to produce plugins, right, in 4 hours, that kind of thing is definitely, you know, a do more or less kind of a concept as well. So definitely these co-pilot and generative AI capabilities, you know, I know it's kind of a broad answer here, but it's definitely going to help your customers and is definitely helping out us as well to have the customers being influenced to have us as like their choice of products and services for sure. Yeah.
What are you doing personally then around your AI upskilling? And I'm not talking just about what you're doing because of, you know, in the role you're in with your focus on Microsoft Copilot and the capabilities of it. But outside of that, you know, you're in tech, I'm in tech, and I'm going, this is a quantum leap, and how do I make it part of every part of my life, right? I'm a all-in type person. What are you doing to kind of really embrace AI and lean into it?
Yeah, no, that's a good, great question. And what I've been personally been doing so far is I've been playing around with not just the GPT, but other AI models as well. I've been trying to kind of use both the AI capabilities in both personal side and work as well. So some of the things I tried was Stable Diffusion, which is one of the AI models you can run on your PC to draw something that I think people is familiar with DALL-E, I think one of the major ones. Stable Diffusion is very similar to that. And you know, I've been playing around on how I can make my own AI portrait model myself using Stable Diffusion. Yes. And it has been fascinating to see that you can just do that in your own personal computer. Right? And that was one thing I've tried. The other thing I've also been working on was before, you know, Azure OpenAI was a thing. And I tried also using ChatGPT as well. And
yes.
And that's definitely one of the earlier days. And then I started to kind of try out different AI capabilities. Like, for example, Adobe Photoshop Beta now has generative filling capabilities that
yes.
automatically creates pictures. So I've been trying out very different types of AI to be familiar and to be able to kind of talk, you know, maybe in a general level on, you know, what are the AI capabilities that's out there. And what I'm particularly focused and interested on a personal and business level is how the AI is being applied to the daily lives and the daily work, more so than the actual model itself. There's lots of people who's, you know, already a specialist focusing on the actual AI models itself. And I'm not a data scientist or a Python developer, to be really transparent. So my focus is kind of more towards how do we enable that to our lives? How do we enable that to our, you know, our business and work and the daily processes and things? And that's kind of my more of interest there, actually.
Have you, outside of Adobe's image generation, which I've played with it, have you, you know, and I have a subscription to GPT-4 and or OpenAI, and also to what's the other one I have? To Midjourney, and I've looked at Stable Diffusion, and then I'm like almost justifying why I need to get even a larger computer, right, to do that processing and a larger GPU. I think Stable Diffusion's amazing, as in, I think Midjourney is accessible to everybody, but Stable Diffusion, I think, can go a lot further. But it's kind of nuanced in that it's still, I feel, you've got to have a technical mind much more than a Midjourney, in my experience. What have you thought around the areas of personal assistance? You know, we've had Google Home, we've had Alexa, we've had Cortana, we've had Siri, all of them are dumb in my mind, as in, you know, on my desk here, I have the Google system. And after 3, maybe 4 years of having that, I have commands that I say, unique commands, and it does things like lights up my studio and things. You know that at least once a week, it doesn't understand my command, even though it's been prompted with the same phrase every day for 4 years. And I'm like, there's obviously no learning, right? There's not, if it was a biometric scan of my voice and all the nuances, whether I said it with a cold or whether I said it in summer or winter or, you know, said it as I just passed the door, and it would pick up the nuances and still build out the model and go, yeah, that's a 92% accurate, he's asking for that. Not, oh, do a Google search on the phrase, that, which is what it does as an alternative, right? What are your thoughts around that space? Like, surely one of the owners of those, although I was surprised to see Cortana's just been discontinued on the Windows 11 platform just in the last couple of weeks. Do you think that, or what's your expectations on whether one of those players are going to apply an LLM to it and even further? And really start to make it the absolute king of the hill when it comes to its powerfulness?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. And I'm also surprised, you know, personally, that the LLM model hasn't been, you know, put into to any of the personal assistants at the moment. I mean, Microsoft, you know, in a sense, Power Virtual Agents is kind of like a personal agent, right? Is a personal assistant. And we've already put GPT, Azure OpenAI, I should be more specific there, that it can be used to automatically generate answers that's relevant to the question. So in that sense, I think, you know, it's a matter of time that one of the big players, you know, in Google or Facebook or Google or Apple or we'll be doing that for sure. One thing I think that's difficult in a sense is that if you're talking about business, you have a particular case, you have a particular intent, you have a kind of particular domain about it. And that's why PVA, Private Virtual Agents with Azure OpenAI's for most recent update, I think it was on August 7, where they released an announcement about bring your own data's Azure OpenAI capabilities is now can be infused with Private Virtual Agents. And that's kind of a domain specific, is intent specific as well. Whereas personal assistants, it could be anything. It could be initially from like booking an Uber to, what's the weather for tomorrow, which makes it much more harder into kind of, I suppose, grounding the models to be in that particular mode, right? And one of the things about generative AI models is that you have to have, meta prompts. Basically, meta prompts are a way of making sure the behavior of the responses are made in one particular way. And you have to have those meta prompts in place beforehand to provide an answer that's kind of the user's intent. Now, if you try and do that with something like a personal asset, you have to have loads of different meta prompts in a way to be able to answer that. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's kind of difficult, because generative AI in general, any LLM models, is not an AI that was built from previous AIs. Like, for example, if you have a recommendation engine, that's a particular set of data set, a particular set of data that was used to learn for the AI models to become AI models. Whereas LLM, large language models, they don't actually teach the models what is right and what is wrong. The purpose of the AI is to generate answers, generate contents. And that's what the purpose is, which makes it much more harder to control. And that's why we have at Microsoft these grounding, and we have these meta prompts in place in our products beforehand to make sure that it's behaving in a way that's intended to behave. And that makes it really hard. And I know I'm getting a little bit kind of technical and deeper here, but no, I think that's one of the reasons why it makes it really hard for personal assistants to be using kind of these large language models, I would say.
Final question, because we're out of time. Where are you going to invest your time personally, do you think, over the next 12 months in your learning development? What is Taiki going to do based on your observations of the world you're living in at the moment?
So I think as a technical person, one of the key things that would be differentiating the top performers and those who aren't is to definitely use the AI capability, generative AI capabilities, to do more pretty much every aspect. So for me, to understand and learn all these different examples of how people are using generative AI capabilities is something that I'm definitely going to pursue in my career as well in the next 12 months. How can I make myself efficient? How can I do more using these capabilities as well? So that's definitely something that I'm going to be particularly focused on too. And even in work kind of point of view as well, I'm going to be trying to create contents, create different topics and assets for other people to be able to use these capabilities too and infuse it in the business. So I don't know if you've seen some of the blog posts recently, but two recent blog posts I wrote about, I just talked about today here in the podcast as well, about Miyu's story, about Ashley's story. And they both have kind of clear examples of how people's using it. And that's, kind of my passion in both, personal side and business side of things, I would say.
Hey, thanks for listening. I'm your host, Business Application MVP Mark Smith, otherwise known as the NZ365 Guy. If there's a guest you'd like to see on the show from Microsoft, please message me on LinkedIn. If you want to be a supporter of the show, please check out buymeacoffee.com/NZ365Guy. How will you create on the Power Platform today? Ciao.